Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. 2012 was a bountiful year for political cartoonists. It was an election year which, by default, guarantees absolutely no shortage of material. Tonight, we take a look at 2012 through the eyes of Brian Fairrington, a nationally syndicated political cartoonist who makes his home in the East Valley, and Steve Benson, Pulitzer Prize-winning political cartoonist for the Arizona Republic. Good to have you both here again for our yearly get-together, and it's a pleasure for you as well. Sorry. Let's move on. Yes?
I got to say, I thought we got rid of the plastic Ken doll when Romney lost, but it's good to see you again.
That's great. Let's start here with the idea that it was a political year, and political years, election years, they should be just a bountiful of riches for you guys.
Yeah, you know, the election years like this every 4 years are the Super Bowl for cartoonists and satirists, and we were overloaded with garbage from the, from both the left and the right, and I'm frankly glad it's over with the primaries and the long election.
Did it ever get to the point where you just sit there and please stop it? Every day there was something new?
Well, it was intense, like Brian said, but I have been doing this for 30 years, believe it or not, and I have never seen so much, I'm going to use a big word here, animus, vitriol, vituperativeness, mm-hmm. and all that stuff.
I got to look that up.
it was pretty mean, pretty ugly, but every day was different, and it was kind of fun, actually, because the Gannett chain had me team up with a conservative cartoonist out of Minneapolis, Gary Varvel, and we were doing counterpoint.
Well, it's kind of like what we do every year here, a little bit of point-counterpoint, mm-hmm. A little bit.
Young, old, fresh, old.
Sure, sure, yeah, I agree. Let's get it started here, and we'll get to the election in a second, but we'll start with Arizona, and the idea of immigration in Arizona never goes away, Steve.
It never goes away, and to add to that, Jan Brewer never goes away. I mean, she's got this idea that we'll give in to the deferred action program where kids who were brought here without any choice of their own can go to school and can work, but we're not going to give them licenses to get to either place. It's just fundamentally unfair, and it's not their fault. And these kids are great; they add to the economy, they join the military. And they end up being productive citizens. And Jan is not a productive citizen. She's a counterproductive governor.
Well,
she's hitting reporters now. She's slugging them.
That's what I hear. Apparently there's physical activity involved. Mission accomplished. This, of course, goes back to the Bush administration. And this was the idea that a lot of folks thought SB 1070 survived and was celebrated by the Supreme Court. And other folks thought otherwise.
Well, on two out of the three basic pillars of the law, the court struck it down. But they did uphold the right of police officers to ascertain immigration status at the point of stop during whatever the enforcement action is. So, she took this mission accomplished and ran with it, and we all know how accomplished the mission was. What the court is waiting for is a test case where somebody who is stopped and believes that they've been profiled. And I think the court, in all likelihood, will strike down the third pillar.
Do you think, Brian, obviously the immigration here would have you hugged a Mexican today. Do you believe that is this going to just come and go as far as policy issues in Arizona are concerned? Is every election now, will we see this rise again?
Well, it's going to be, Arizona and all the border states are hotbed. It'll be a hotbed issue. I think that Arizona, like a lot of places, will adopt a sensible policy over time. That's what the public will want. But it's going to be a hotbed issue. From the right wants extremism, and the left, wants to be a little bit more lenient.
Reasonable.
And I think a reasonable policy is justified. I mean, the Hispanic people that come to this country do a lot for our economy, and they, provide for our in our society, and I think more people are realizing that.
We'll get back to the election in a second. You mentioned reasonable ideas and policies. Mass shootings in the headlines this year, unfortunately. How do you do? I see your cartoon here, but how do you deal with something like that?
Well, this regarding Aurora at the Batman screening, it's a culture of violence. It's a culture of, where people don't know how to turn and don't know what to do, and so they turn to violence. And it's going to, like immigration, it's going to be a hotbed issue for a long time.
But you've got the Batman tearing up his NRA card.
Well, yeah, Batman's strong on crime, but he's also, in this cartoon, he's also fed up with what the NRA has lacked to do, and that's stand up. There's nothing wrong with owning guns and the protection of the Second Amendment, but there's also nothing wrong with entertaining the idea of you know, licensing handguns and things like that.
And Steve, you've got the NRA as well here.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think the NRA is complicit. I mean, any proposed gun law is an automatic enemy to the NRA. I think they're extremists in their positions. I privately own a gun. I was a cop for 9 years. I have nothing against the Heller Amendment, excuse me, the Heller decision by the Supreme Court, which said you have a constitutional right to protect your domicile and self using a firearm. But, you know, unlimited magazines in terms of their capacity, easy access to guns. I think there needs to be better coordination between federal and state laws for background checks so that these kinds of folks don't slip through the cracks. And the absurd argument is that if these people only had had guns, they would have been able to fight back like in Aurora in a crowded black, you know, dark theater. It would have been mass mayhem. It would have been a massacre brought to you by the NRA.
Do you get much of a response, and I know the answer to this, but much of a response on anything that deals with gun issues?
Oh, absolutely. I just did a cartoon on, you know, the player for the Atlanta Braves who, you know, offed himself and his girlfriend.
The Chief.
And the Braves, too. I mean, they're all messed up in this market. Kansas City Chiefs. And, had him in the pistol offense, had the NRA in the pistol office, where he's just kind of shooting away.
Response when you criticize the NRA?
Well, you know, they're a powerful lobby. They're one of the most powerful in the country, and so if they post any cartoon or any criticism on a website, you get overloaded with emails. But, you know, I think it's important as far as the gun issue goes is, you know, certainly we have to look at what causes the violence. I mean, the gun is probably the mechanism that causes it, but we have to look at, you know, why we have a culture of violence.
And obviously the entertainment industry is something that you see as partly
faulty.
Well, yeah,
when you have video games, my kids, you know, my boys want games and they all involve shooting and blowing stuff up and, you know, and we had that, but it was, you know, doing this with, you know, asteroids.
And,
yeah, exactly,
yeah.
You know, but.
All right, back to the election here. I don't know, Brian, what it is about Newt Gingrich, but you certainly have a thing for this. Is he just fun to draw?
Yeah, he was fun. The primaries went on longer than normal because of the the campaign situation this year, and he didn't get out. And Newt Gingrich went against the cardinal rule that St. Reagan sent, was that thou shalt not talk negatively against fellow Republicans, and you know they just went after Romney. Full force. And
Newt's still going after the GOP. He'll meet the press recently. He said, you know, we're going to be out of the national spotlight unless we reform and come into synchronization with the rest of the country. You know?
But here we go again with this huge head. I mean, this is almost like a...
Yeah, he's great to draw. And, you know, they tried to, after a while, I think the establishment wanted him to just go away and bury him so they could get on with Romney, which they never fell in love with in the first place.
Yeah.
So, it would have been interesting had he got the nomination, but I don't think there was a chance in heck if he actually would have. But
so that, again, was the primary.
He's going to be a political figure for a long time.
Yes, so. Of course. And Republican primary there on a national scale. As far as Arizona is concerned, we had our own politician who had some curiosities unveiled.
Yeah, well, you know, I don't give a tinker's a darn about his sexual orientation, but he showed extremely poor judgment by posting his availability on a gay website. I don't know if that means that he shouldn't be sheriff.
Of the mayor of Tempe, wasn't it? Neil did the same thing.
There have been some public officials with the same penchant. But it was, you know, I just thought it was extremely bad judgment on his part.
All right. It's tough to do a cartoon on that as well. I mean, is that an easy cartoon to do, or is that something that...
Well, I didn't have to spend
Steve
a lot...
Steve researched the website heavily to get all these images, I'm sure.
I didn't have to spend a lot of time on his hair, you know.
I got you. As far as a national debate, election debate, and all these kinds of things are concerned, it was interesting to watch the ebb and flow of this particular campaign season. The president was high, the president was low, the president was some point in between, and you thought that rising prices with gasoline was a big factor there, at least.
It was for a while, and certainly his opposition was trying to make it that way. They conveniently were ignoring the fact, however, that under Bush, gasoline hit $4 a gallon for the first time. But people, you know, blamed the president, and he was suffering for a while for rising gas prices, but the president really doesn't have much control over that.
The economy was supposed to be the major factor in this
election. Well, yeah, and that's what's interesting. You would think, I mean, it was Romney's race to lose, and he definitely lost it. If you can't beat Obama under these, on paper, under these circumstances with the economy, I mean, you know, and Romney, as word has it, was totally shocked that he lost. Which was, it's just shocking that he thought that. But you know, it like a lot of, now that Obama has a second term, he's going to get the blame when things are bad, and if things turn around, he'll come out looking better than he does.
And you got the president down here with the shovel, and basically when you're...
Well, I think going into it, I mean, there's no question that Obama inherited the economy. It's just what he did with it in the last 4 years, and I think that there comes a point in the next 4 years that he's going to have to take all the credit of what happens.
Steve, someone suggested the reason the president won was because Republicans went too far in one particular direction, and that direction wasn't near the center. You agree with that?
Absolutely. In fact, the biggest slice of the electorate is the moderate section of the populace, and he, you know, the backup singer for the GOP were running around the stage, you know, ripping their clothes off and pulling their toupees off and making scenes and making stupid statements. You got Todd Akin, you know, about legitimate rape. You had Mr. Murdoch, I use Mr. loosely, talking about a rape-induced pregnancy as a gift from God. I mean, these guys were totally out of touch with the concerns and the realities of women, and you know, Romney lost the one vote. He lost a lot of other segments too.
Well, you know, the GOP is going to have to come back to the center if they want any success in the future. They can't be extremist right. They're going to have to attract more people to the party, and you know, Akin and others are example of what a lot of the moderates, you know, want to distance themselves from. He's a primary example of that.
And the birther movement was another example.
You know, they I think a lot of the rational Republicans, and I know that's an oxymoron, but I think a lot of them thought that that the birther movement was just insane. And you have, you know, Arpaio going over and sending people over into you know, to investigate Obama. It's ridiculous. It's really ridiculous.
You also had Donald Trump, who was very big on the birther issue and was considered, I don't know for how brief a time, was he really a viable?
Well, I think in his own mind, I mean, he's got the ego that's bigger than, you know, New York City. But he, you know, it's questionable what's under that odd haircut of his. although I admire people with good haircuts.
And you like to draw people with those kinds of haircuts too, don't you?
What
are you saying here, Steve, with this Air Force One flying over?
Well, you know, Obama has been to our state a few times, and of course he's. First concern is, can he land here and be legitimate, or is Brewer going to wag her finger at him at the tarmac and say, "Where's your damn birth certificate?"
By the way, this cartoon, you gave special thanks to someone. Do you get all of your ideas from other people?
Oh yeah, well this was thanks a lot. Yeah, my editor, and Brian helps me. You know, so no, this was actually a reader that contributed this, and they won.
Yeah. All right, at least you gave them credit. That's nice to see.
That's what we do every week.
Uh-huh.
And they're the best cartoons
of the
week.
Over there at the Republic.
and the birther issue, obviously, you mentioned with Arizona here with the Air Force One flying over, and then we had Ken Bennett inexplicably wading into those waters.
Yeah, I mean, he toyed with the idea. He didn't come out and just distance himself completely, firmly, and quickly from this, and so he got tagged, rightly so, as being a birth, but I think he was doing
it for political reasons. It's people in the GOP try to serve two masters. They're trying to appease the far right, but at the same time, you know, that's why he waffled on the issue, because I think he probably realized that he doesn't want to end up.
And real quickly, before we leave the birther issue, that's an uncomfortable culture.
Well, you know, it was Arpaio sends five deputies over. They go to the State Department of Records in Honolulu and demand to have the original birth certificate given to them so they can take it back to Arizona and test it. The governor has confirmed that it's authentic. The State Records Department has confirmed it's authentic. But we all know this was a big conspiracy between the two newspapers in August of, 1961 to work out these stories of his phony birth in the United States.
You know, that behavior is what's amazing is Arpaio does all these things, and yet he still gets reelected.
He got reelected.
And what is this, his fifth time now, going on 20 years? And the guy's 81 years old? I mean, he just, he's amazing.
He's,
and he's good for
than
cartoonists.
The but pink underwear he never changes.
Yeah, pink with...
All right, let's move on, please. back to the national election. We've got the Etch-a-Sketch with Romney. That one looked like it was, that probably just came, just... Almost came gift wrapped for you.
It came gift wrapped, and it was just like his chief staff advisor said, well, you know, the primary is one thing, but after the primary is over, we just do a little Etch-a-Sketch wiggle, and we reorient for the general. I mean, it was so blatantly political and consciousness.
And another thing that people are still scratching their heads over is just bringing up Big Bird as a casualty?
Well, you know, the fact is PBS, and we're on PBS, they represent such a small, small portion of the budget that to eliminate PBS is ridiculous. And again, it's just playing to the extremists in the party. And
to eliminate this cartoon show is even more ridiculous.
we'll see about
it's
that.
It's been nice.
But and again, regarding Big Bird, and this not so much Big Bird on this one, I can't tell you how many people told me that what really bothered them was the story of roof racking your dog on a vacation. I mean, it's in the grand scheme of things, it's not a big deal, but for a lot of folks, that was a big deal.
It was a big deal, and the story came out because of one of Romney's sons flirted it out. We had a great vacation, and Shane was tied to the top and couldn't control his bowels and was awful.
Well, in all fairness, the guy, he wasn't probably a very nice, expensive dog carrier, he was probably a well-treated dog, by the way. But it was an example of politics at its best, where the opposition took this and played it and put it back in their face, and it was effective.
Two Shears Dogs Against Romney. I mean, those were great.
Don't roof rack me, bro. That was a song, actually.
Yeah, that's right.
And now, Steve, you're talking about the capture of bin Laden. Do you think that really was as big a deal as people thought it was going to be at the time in terms of the election?
No, but it did serve to establish Obama's foreign policy bona fides.
Well, Biden said, regard to that, that GM is alive and bin Laden is dead, and that was sort of their calling card.
That was a great line. And so I think that he really did, he was the guy that got bin Laden. Well, Bush set it up and it was a 12-year hunt and blah, 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 and he didn't really pull the trigger himself. This is desperation politics.
And yet this wound up, regardless of what side you were rooting for, it was still a horse race, wasn't it? At least in terms of the total vote, it was. Electoral College, not so much, but this was a close race.
Well, it was. I had a bet with my editor for a steak dinner, 4 to 7 points, and I won in the popular vote. But you look at the meshing of all the elements together, Electoral College, the popular vote, the swing states, the segments of the population you lost. I thought in the end Romney got pounded.
I thought Romney was going to win, and I lost a steak dinner, so I owe somebody a steak dinner at City Hall or some expensive
It wasn't place. A steak dinner like this one that Benson drew, is it? That's not a palatable meal there.
Yeah, I had readers calling and say, how dare you insult the great memory of John the Baptist, because John the Baptist had his head headed to on a platter. But I told him, I said, look, if Obama was John the Baptist president, he would make sure he dressed well and got into the upper middle income through the taxes on the rich.
All right, now election over. Now the fiscal cliff. I mean, the fiscal, here it comes, and there it goes.
It's Thelma and Louise, two over the cliff. And, you scratch your head and you wonder, there's a notion out there that it's a strategy now for some of them to let it go over the cliff. But you wonder, If politicians care about the constituency or what it's going to do. It's just, you can see why people despise politicians.
We're going to see how much they despise or love Hillary Rodham Clinton come 2016. She seems to be the front runner, but this suggests that the world's blowing up around her.
Well, it's a great campaign song by Bruno Mars, I love you just the way you are. But look, you don't tell nuts in Iran, we're not going to set deadlines. That just encourages the nuts in Iran to continue to build the nukes. That was giving away your game. That was, I thought, just totally counterproductive.
General Petraeus, do we need to say anything more here?
It's self-explanatory. And again, you wonder why the head of the CIA and America's stellar five-star foreign intelligence agency, the guy didn't know that people could read his email. I mean, it makes you wonder. But it shows that, people fall at the highest levels to sexual scandals because, men are only concerned about two things in this world, and one of them is blowing stuff up.
And it's fun to draw people with lots of bars and stars.
Yeah, it's fun to draw uniforms.
Yes.
It's fun to draw uniforms.
Okay.
Speaking of uniforms, you got the refs, right?
Yeah, this was
I love that. Everyone's jumping down the throats as the replacement refs, and when they finally go bye-bye and the regular refs go on, they're booing them.
Yeah, sure. That's fun. I mean, that's a great look. This next one's a little uncomfortable to see. This is Steve Nash as Beelzebub.
I tell you, man, the reaction I got to this cartoon was, how dare you make fun of St. Steve, St. Nash. It was like, I had spit on, Mother Teresa's grave or something. It's just a cartoon. And, yeah, he's going to the Lakers to get a better team and a better deal. I mean, can you blame him?
I have to admit, I was not really all that up on this story of Disney buying Star Wars.
Because you were one of those kids that read books and didn't watch Star Wars.
What are you trying to say?
It was kind of a surprise. It was kind of a surprise because I don't think people expected it, that George Lucas would sell out like he did to Disney. Now Disney owns, not only do they own Star Wars, but they own Marvel, they own the Muppets.
They
bought the Muppets.
I hope Disney did something with Star Wars because Lucas got so involved.
Well, that's why a lot of the fans
he tinkered
too much, and I think a lot of us think that perhaps this will be good for the franchise.
What, like Bambi starts walking around in
a
space costume?
There you go.
All right, and also Brian, you've got an opinion on what is this? This is the idea that sugar now is against the law in New York.
Well, you know, Bloomberg issued this order that they weren't going to allow to sell certain. Ounces above a certain amount of ounces, and I think
supersized 16-ounce drinks.
Yeah, supersized drinks, and I think a lot of people felt that it was kind of ridiculous, and people can sidestep around it very easily. They can go buy two drinks. You know, it's not like they can't abandon it. I think it's symbolic. Certainly America has a weight problem and a sugar problem, but mm-hmm. I think the mayor would probably be better suited dealing with things that are more.
And in a purely artistic fashion. You had to show the cops as being heavy, correct?
I mean,
there's no way around that.
That's just
literally and figuratively, I suppose.
It's not just the donuts, huh?
Yes.
Okay. And Steve, as far as global warming is concerned, again, now you talk about issues that a lot of folks thought would be front and center in the election. I don't remember global warming is getting all that much attention.
No,
climate
it didn't.
Change or
the
anyone
no, business. Where it started getting attention was Superstorm Sandy, and what you have is you have a late season. A hurricane level, although it didn't actually reach that technically, force a storm that is fueled by the warm waters of the ocean. And the waters are staying warmer because the climate is heating up, and the climate is heating up because we're spewing man-made.
Well, I think Sandy ended up helping Obama because he at the end there, at the end result, he ended up looking very presidential.
Yeah, presidential, yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
but
as far as climate change is concerned, that is stuff. And again, on a cartoon like this, and when you do climate change or global warming, anything, cards and letters come in?
Not really much anymore. I think that there's kind of a slow acceptance of climate change as being real science. It's not the hot button that used to be, so to speak.
Before we let you go, the changing nature of technology, let's talk craft here. Will you still doodle on the sheet of paper?
Doodle on the sheet of paper, and I have originals to prove it. This guy does everything in his computer brain, Hal the 9000 computer, Dave, what are you doing? Dave, what are you doing? Stop, Dave. Use the right template here, Dave. But for me, my stuff is just pure ink out of the bottle, onto the paper, into the paper, and I have originals to sell.
And
he's never had an original.
Both ways up in the snow on the way to school.
That's right. And
he has an inkwell that
But I mean, does it change anything?
Well, in all fairness, Steve doesn't live totally in the dinosaur age. He emails things, and I mean, we do live in that age. But, technology is changing. I mean, there's devices now where you can draw right onto the tablets, like iPads kind of devices, Wacom tablets and things like that. And I haven't graduated to that. I do a lot of stuff in Photoshop and of programs like that. But it's just another form, another way to do it. It's not really any quicker, any better. And the younger generation coming up, they're sort of adapting to that, and I think you'll see that.
Another question regarding technology. With the internet, the interweb, as we like to call
yes.
it, is so prominent, so just taking over everything. Does it change the nature of delivery? Does it change the nature of how you prepare, how you deliver? Because, it used to be Benson Cartoon is there, and the Benson Cartoon's going to be there till the next one shows. You go to the internet now, you can see Benson Cartoons from, really, the dinosaur age.
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing now is because of the interweb, you basically have circulation delivery of
yes.
your paper 24/7. We have a constantly morphing daily site, AZ, Central, and we're putting up first run, first production. They say that journalism is history on a daily basis, and so people aren't wedded to.
Now it's more than a daily basis. Now
it's hour by hour.
Right.
And we're updating hour by hour.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll stop it right there, gentlemen. Once again, a good year for cartoonists and a good year for us having you here. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good to be here.
All right. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.